Okay, I think we're live. Hey everyone, welcome to Victory Condition Gaming. My name is Doug, and tonight we have a very special treat for you. We are going to live play some Tiny Dungeon 2E, or second edition, as it's said on the Kickstarter. Tiny Dungeon is currently on Kickstarter right now. It just crossed $50,000 in funding. Congratulations, Alan.
Thanks.
That's a very huge benchmark for a crowdfunding project. So if you are interested in checking out Tiny Dungeon 2nd Edition, I'm going to tell you to look at the link down below in the description of this video. Hopefully we give you a good idea of what it's like. I'm going to get introduced to our players, our GM, and we're just going to get going. Starting us all off is the man himself, the founder of Gallant Knight Games, the creator of Tiny Dungeon 2nd Edition, Alan Barr. Alan, thanks for coming on and doing this for us tonight.
Of course, happy to be here.
Are you really, though? Or are you just saying that?
I'm just saying that.
Yeah, I figured. It's all right.
That's cool. I just didn't have better plans, so I couldn't get out of it when you asked.
I'm going to try to keep the chat open as well so I can kind of address anybody that might have any questions. Do you want to tell folks a little bit about yourself, who you are, what you do?
Yeah, I'm Alan Barr. I'm the founder, senior game designer, only game designer of Gallant Knight Games. I am Gallant Knight Games, functionally speaking, I suppose, as I'm the only employee.
That's all right. But
Gallant Knight Games is part of... Gallant Knight Games is a game company. We make role-playing games and card games and stuff. So,
very cool.
I design the stuff we make, and I write it, and then I manage it to production, and then I do the shipping, and then I weep tears of blood, and then I do it again.
It's all right. And you do it well, sir. That's the main thing.
Well, I appreciate the kind words.
Well, if anything is a testament to that, it's the amount of funding for this project. This is your highest funded project so far, right? For Gallant Knight Games?
Games project ever. Yeah.
That's awesome.
Yeah.
Crazy. You just went over, like, what is it, 1,200 backers? Are you pushing 1,300 now at this point?
I think so. Let me see. I think I had it open.
That's pretty crazy. The amount of
we're pushing 1,400 backers.
Oh, that's awesome. Congratulations. The amount of content, I guess is the word I'm looking for, that you get with each pledge is just amazing. And if anybody is interested in this at all, now's the time to jump on, because you just get so much included. Well, it's crazy. It really is. I don't know of any other RPG pledge that has that much value added to it. And this month right now is a huge month for RPGs on Kickstarter. So that's saying a lot. In my opinion. I don't know. Maybe others will disagree, but that's just how I feel. All right, now let's go down the list, and we will introduce Amanda Call. Amanda, you might have seen Amanda a few times on this channel. Amanda, do you want to introduce yourself? Tell the folks who you are, what you do.
Hello, I'm Amanda Call. I'm a comic artist and freelance illustrator. I have my own webcomic, fantasy story, called The Age of Night, which you can check out. And also I do all sorts of illustrating for different game companies. So, oh, and there's my cat hanging out. That's George. There he goes. He might show up again. Where was I? Oh, yeah. So I do a lot of illustrating for different game companies. Also, I am the art director in much the same way that Alan is the owner and game designer for his company. I'm the art director for Fear Light Games because I'm the only one doing the art.
You know what? That's awesome. And you do a very, very good job. You do a very good job for Fear Light. They have a Kickstarter going right now for Baker Street and Hood content. So if anybody is curious about anything that Amanda is also tied with, please check out their Kickstarter as well. There's still a few weeks left on that.
There's too many good things. Yes, there's too many good things on Kickstarter right now.
There are.
This is the Hood RPG, right?
Right. So Hood, Swashbuckling Adventures in Sherwood.
And the Baker Street one, right? It's the double.
Sherlock.
All the adventures.
And then We've got. Well, I'll leave Jordan. Jordan looks like he's got his hands full for right now, so we won't move to him right yet. Let's go to Josh Melville. Josh, also known as Halloweenville on YouTube. If you haven't checked out Halloweenville, search for it on YouTube. Josh, thanks for coming on tonight and doing this. You want to introduce yourself and tell folks who you are, what you do?
Absolutely. Like Doug said, I have a Halloween. I'm Halloweenville on YouTube. I craft many things using everyday items you might find in your home.
Say hi.
Like this costume here, a lot of it's made out of cardboard and cereal box. So I do cool stuff like this. I also make miniature terrain for Dungeons & Dragons games or any kind of role-playing game, really, where you really want to get into it. And got a lot of cool stuff on my channel, a lot of unboxing of games. And some gameplay videos.
Nice, nice. So, yeah, everybody check that out. Also, folks can find you on Facebook as well. You have a Facebook page?
Yes, absolutely. You can find Halloweenville on Facebook as well.
Nice. Very cool. All right, and looks like last but certainly not least is Jordan Streeter. Jordan, as you can see, Jordan has a little one in his household, and
hello, I'm in. Okay. Sorry about that.
It's okay. It's all right. We've all been there, my friend.
That is Owen.
Hey, Owen.
I just want to be clear. I have never been there.
Oh well, yeah. It's all right. You've got dogs though, right, Alan?
Yes, and that's why they're in their kennels.
I've got three.
Hey, Jordan, you got to get Owen in his kennel.
I am not putting him in a kennel.
I think that's against the law of some kind, right?
Yeah, probably a couple of them.
Wait, what's those pack and play things? That's pretty much a kennel.
No, it's
he climbs out of them now.
Right, it's just a pack and play until you put a top on it.
Oh,
when you put a top on it, then it's a cage, and then it's no longer okay.
Then it's against the law. Okay, good to know.
Exactly. You can drill some air holes. It's still not okay.
No. Jordan, let's introduce you. Jordan Streeter, he is a rep for Slugfest Games and also is the founder behind Gamers Against Alzheimer's, which is a team for the Alzheimer's Association. Jordan, do you want to introduce yourself and tell folks a little bit about what you do?
Sure. I am a game demonstrator for Slugfest Games, and also I'm a tournament organizer. I have several tournaments coming up for Red Dragon Inn, which is kind of the flagship game for Slugfest.
I love that game.
Right? It's awesome.
You should. Can you hook me up with promos?
I can't. But
he can't. Wink, wink, wink.
If you come to the tournaments, though. If you come to the tournaments,
it's really far for a tournament. How about you come to Utah and run a tournament?
Maybe.
No, hey, don't tempt him. He will go.
I
would go to the tournament if it was here.
Alrighty. I will keep that in mind. I am, and as Doug said, I'm also the founder and kind of like Alan, only employee of Gamers Against Alzheimer's. We're starting off as a walk team for the Walk to End Alzheimer's for the Williston chapter. And hoping by next year to have some more than just myself and my wife and our son. We're a fledgling charity.
That's awesome though. It's hey, you have to start out somewhere, and I'm glad that it's a very very worthwhile cause to do it. When you were thinking of the idea, you emailed me. It's like, do you know if there's any charities that do gaming and Alzheimer's? And I hadn't heard of any. And so I'm so glad that you kind of picked up that torch and ran with it. And it's great.
I've since then found some similar ones, but not specifically Alzheimer's Association ones. There's like Able Gamers, things like that. I found.
Okay. The other thing that I'm going to tell you about Jordan is this guy is one heck of a promoter for and demonstrator for Slugfest. I have never seen somebody, and I've seen a lot of, and I'm gonna embarrass him a little bit because I really want to stress this a lot. Jordan is the only guy that I know that I've seen where he has been to a convention, demoed a product, and people literally walk away, go to the vendor, buy armloads of Red Dragon in, like literally armloads. This one guy, I saw two of them, literally wiped out one of the vendors for Red Dragon in. He left with like a whole stack, and I've never seen that happen before. So this guy can sell stuff right here. I'm going to tell you right now, if anybody's watching and they want to, they want someone demoing their game, you go talk to Jordan. He does a very good job.
Thank you very much. To be fair, the gentleman in question had just won the tournament, and the prize is a card for the game. So,
yeah,
but you gotta have to buy the game, or else your prize is useless.
Yeah, but you get one card. I mean, that doesn't. I mean, the guy walked away with like hundreds of dollars of game, and like it was pretty crazy. And I was just like, oh my gosh! Like, and then he had like another guy that walked away with a whole armload as well. So, but anyway, that's beside the point. I just wanted to say it while we were on because I think it should be stressed a lot because hopefully someone from Slugfest or some other company realizes what a good job you do and maybe they'll contact you. I don't know. We'll see. But anyway, we're not here to. We're not here for
hire me.
let's talk some little tiny dungeon. You guys all ready?
Ready? Yeah, let's do this.
All right, Alan, where do we begin? Let's. I think you're on mute.
That's why I was making sure I wasn't chewing in your guys' ear because I'm still scarfing down dinner.
That's all right.
Let's introduce everybody's characters.
Oh, yeah. Okay. Jordan, why don't you go first?
Okay. I am Klingstone, the tree folk Tai Chi master. I am 12 foot tall. Actually, this camera angle kind of works with the kind of Chuck Norris effect, so I look a little taller here. And I am a proficient in unarmed combat, and I don't say a whole lot, and I tend to take life a bit slowly. My belief is not so hasty.
Nice. Josh, you want to tell folks who you are, what your player character is?
Sure. I'm Seamus McPherson, and I'm born to the drink. I mean, I
eat goblin. Hey, Alan, you got leprechauns in your game?
It's a goblin.
I do now.
I play an Irish goblin who is spell-touched.
Nice. Okay.
Hang on. I'm sorry. An Irish goblin?
Yes.
Hey.
Okay. So now we have Ireland. Awesome.
Yeah, exactly.
Or some analog. I mean.
Yeah, you know.
There's. Oh, come on.
Call it not Ireland.
Instead of being the big bad like I usually play, I figured I'd go tiny and small.
And that's fine. No, I like it.
Irish. And because I'm fond of the drink. And so I'm spell touched, and if you get too close, I'll beat you with my shillelagh.
Okay. Good enough. Amanda, why don't you're up next, I guess.
Yes, so I'm playing a lizard folk character by the name of Wootend. And he's kind of he's a former hunter, so he's kind of a sneakety type.
Okay.
A sneakety, grumpity type.
Nice. What do you have for traits, or what?
So, aside from the standard cold-blooded that comes for being a lizard folk, I also have acrobat, opportunist, and sneaky.
Nice. I am going to be playing a fae. Oh, I forgot my ears. I was going to wear some ears. Aww. For you, Josh.
Yeah, see how you are?
Oh, darn. Oh,
I at least give
I
you
forgot. Posts,
you know.
Yeah.
That's okay. Wait till Paracon. Me and Rob got some for you.
Oh, great. I am a fae. I am going to be Aiden Radov. And, of course, I'm going to be good with a bow. I've got the quick shot trait. I'm also going to be hopefully our group's healer. We'll see if that helps. And I also have a tracker. I'm going to be a tracker. So hopefully I can track some things in the wild.
Cool.
And I can see where True North is. So it'll be interesting.
That's useful.
Yeah, hopefully.
All right, so let's go over some of the basic mechanics of Tiny Dungeon. So we're all on the same page. So Tiny Dungeon resolves around the concept of the test, which in a super generic RPG term means you roll dice and do a thing. It's not that exciting. So normally you roll two six-sided dice. If either dice shows a 5 or 6, you succeed. You don't total them up. They're separate. You just have to roll a 5 or 6 on one of the two dice. And if you do, you do the thing. It's that simple. If you have something that would give you advantage, like a piece of equipment, favorable weather conditions, or in some cases a trait, you get to roll 3 dice. And on a 5, if one of those dice shows a 5 or 6, you succeed. If you have disadvantage, you roll 1 dice. That's the whole system. There's no skills, there's no bonuses, there's nothing. It's just
love
roll
it.
1 to 3 dice.
And crits?
There's no crits.
There's no crits?
No, there's never been.
I thought if you rolled all sixes, you get the.
That's an optional rule.
Oh, optional rule.
Yeah, so there's no crits. Crits is an optional rule. So thanks, Doug.
Okay.
Tell everybody that.
But sorry, I read so many RPG books, I always forget. Like I knew that there was some sort of crit mentioned in the book. I couldn't remember.
That's all good. Yeah. So there's no crits. There's no automatic failures. All attacks do 1 damage. There's no armor. It's that simple. The weapon you use doesn't matter. A sword does 1 damage. A punch does 1 damage. A magic missile does 1 damage. Some monsters do more than 1 damage, just so you know. Because they're monsters.
Great.
Mm-hmm.
I think that's it. Characters, you know, as you guys saw when you made your characters, for the benefit of those watching, characters are a heritage, which is a culture / species. And that species comes with a hit point number. And then a special species heritage trait. And then you can pick 3 other traits. You pick a weapon you're good with that you have advantage on, and you're done. That's it. It's that simple.
Nice.
So, you folks have already made your characters. We won't have to do character creation on the live stream.
Nope.
So, we will start. All right. So, for ease of play, since this is a one-off, we will assume you all know each other and have been working together for some time.
Can I get everybody's names again? I forgot to write that down.
I wrote them down.
Yes.
So, we have Seamus. We have Klingstone.
Klingstone.
The Tree Folk. We have Wootind. Is that right?
Yes.
Awesome. And then we have some...
Did you say Wu Clan? Is that what she said?
Wootind.
Oh. Okay, Wootind. All right.
And then there's some prissy elf named Radov or something.
Sorry, did I miss reintroductions? Sorry.
No, we were just getting everybody's character names because I forgot to write them down earlier.
Okay.
Amanda is Wu Clan.
No.
Amanda is all right. What? Sorry.
Nothing. No, never mind. It's a stupid joke.
Okay.
Doug's just giving me a hard time.
Yeah.
Okay.
All right. So you all know each other. You've adventured together for a bit.
Hey, guys.
Oh, boy. So, you have all ended up in the town of Shaybrook. Shaybrook is a small village of about 500 people. It sits in the southern marches. which is a region of the world that has recently become reopened after an earthquake cleared a pass that had been collapsed by avalanche and cascade long ago. So it's sort of a wild frontier in a sense that nobody's really adventured in here in a couple hundred years. So Shavebrook is sort of the entry point at the edge of this pass that has been opened. And you all are, you know, in Shavebrook looking for fame, fortune, wealth, you know, more alcohol, whatever, you know, gets you going in the morning, I suppose.
Excellent.
So, you have a meeting with a dwarf merchant who has a job for you and would like to hire you for something.
Mm-hmm. All right.
He is meeting you at an inn called the Flying Swine.
What is it? The Flying Swine?
The Flying Swine.
Okay.
It is a dump. Nice. The chairs are rickety. They give you splinters if you rub your hand across the table. And you're pretty sure the booze is mostly water.
And it smells like home.
All the way outside.
The dwarf you are meeting is named Brock Gutterdrunk.
Gutterdrunk, okay.
I like him already.
He also owns this establishment.
Oh, great.
The common joke is that his last name refers to where he gets his alcohol that he serves.
Sure.
So, you are sitting at your table while Clingstone waits outside. And the big portly dwarf, very nicely dressed compared to everything else in this place that he runs. Sits down at your table.
All right.
Big bushy beard. You know, he looks like a dwarf. Got the big beard. Everything.
So, yeah.
What's wrong with your ale? It's kind of watered down.
That's a rare gutter drunk vintage. Yeah.
Nice. It's like sewage.
Yeah, I'm not gonna drink any of this swill.
He just starts ignoring Seamus.
It's already in my cup. I'm not gonna throw it away or waste it. Come on, lad, have a drink.
So, what was it that you wanted to contact us about?
So, I have a task at hand that I unfortunately, and he, you know, pats his stomach, am unable to complete as I have grown somewhat comfortable in my rotund and unenergetic life.
All right, do tell. What is this endeavor?
I need you to retrieve a magic sword for me.
Awesome.
What's in it for us?
Yeah, what's...
Well, I will let you keep anything you find on the way, and I will pay you each 15 gold pieces for your troubles.
15. That seems a little low. I mean, that's what... So 60 gold pieces? For all of us?
Seems fair to me.
What do you guys think? Let me talk it over with my group. Wait just a second.
Yeah, of course.
Pull you guys off to the side. Or maybe we have to go out. Maybe we should go out and talk to Clingstone about this.
We probably should.
Yeah, let's go. We'll go outside.
Hey guys, what's going on?
Well, you see this Brock guy. Out that owns this place, he wants us to go retrieve a magic sword, and he's only going to pay us 60 gold. What do you think?
Wait, each?
No.
Split.
Total.
Tell him 30 apiece and I'll do it.
Seamus, what do you think? Seamus, sorry.
Hey. I'm throwing a barrel of the swill, and I'm good.
Is it any good?
AP sounds great.
What do you think? You think let's go back inside.
All right, so you guys re-enter, and he's patiently waiting, kind of sitting there at his table, looking around. He's kind of.
So, Brock, we'll do it for.
As Mr. Gutter Drunk to you.
All right, Mr. Gutter Drunk.
Because that's so much better.
Yeah, because you know. let's double the price, and we'll do it.
All right, doubling seems a bit excessive.
Well,
normally when you negotiate, you increase it by 50%, and then we kind of meet halfway. So why don't we just do that, and I'll meet you at a 25% increase.
Wow, I really don't want to go up. I really don't want to go back out to Clingstone with this.
Clingstone's kind of leaning in, looking through the door, and just kind of cracks his knuckles.
Great. You crack your branches?
Have you ever seen a tree folk when they get angry?
Yeah.
Is this where you tell me if he loses a game, he pulls my arms out or something?
Oh, no. No, no.
Oh.
He wouldn't pull your arms out, but I can't promise as to what would happen to your establishment.
Mm.
Mm. Well, that feels a lot like extortion when I'm trying to hire you for a job. But I also like my tavern, so 30 gold pieces each it is.
Pleasure doing business with you, sir. We shall take on this task.
Excellent. All right. Well, I've got a map for you, and he pulls out a map and like a roll and puts it down. And inside there is a description of the magic sword you need to bring me. Your money will be delivered upon completion.
What's this magic sword look like?
So it's a long sword, so a single hand, longer bladed weapon. It's got a very ornate hilt in the shape of thorn brambles. Kind of they intertwine and weave among themselves with thorns sticking out every little bit. If you were not careful, it looked like you would probably cut yourself on the brambles of the sword.
Okay.
Hmm.
And then the actual hilt is the vines kind of wrapped down in a circular motion like somebody had braided them. And the sword's name is the Iron Thorn Blade.
The Iron Thorn Blade. Nice. Okay.
Iron Thorn.
And the map takes you to a place of the Southern Marches known as the Thaw Crypt.
The what's that?
The Thaw Crypt.
The Thaw Crypt?
Thaw Crypt.
Crypt.
Yeah.
Like tomb. Crypt.
Yeah. Right, like a place full of dead people.
Right.
Yeah.
Oh, great. And how far away is this?
It's like a 3-day journey via mount. If you walk, it's closer to 5.
So, I guess we're all riding Clingstone.
I don't know if he heard.
Is that not the time to make the joke about the tree folk?
Yeah, no.
Sorry, I didn't hear that.
That's probably the best.
Yeah, no, it's for the best, Jordan.
Nah.
You can watch it in the replay.
Oh, great.
Oh. All right, so.
All right.
You guys saddle up your mounts and head on out.
Nice.
Absolutely. Nice.
Great. So one of the concepts in Tiny Dungeon is the concept of the save test. Much like you would expect, it is for making saves. So as you guys travel, it is early spring. The wind is blowing, is cold, is kind of sleeting and snowing all at the same time. You're going to need to make a save test as you travel to avoid getting hypothermia and having to stop early to recover.
Meh.
No, wait a minute. Can we just chop off Clingstone's arm and burn it for fire so that we can stay warm?
That's not very nice.
Yes, you can. It's however, it will not just grow back.
Oh, it's not like Groot?
He's not just Groot, no.
Oh, okay.
You're always so hasty.
Hey, I'm full of ideas. It's the way my brain works.
The speciesism is killing me inside.
All right.
So everybody will need to roll a save. You'll just pick up 2d6. You'll roll them. As long as one of them shows a 5 or 6, you're good.
Yay!
I have awesome. 5.
5.
I did not.
Okay. Ooh. So So we have a Clingstone and Seamus failed. Is that correct?
No, we got a 5.
Oh, just Seamus.
Just Seamus.
Okay. Well, so about... If it's like midday, you know, you guys have been traveling for the morning and the poor goblin on his riding hog is like over there shivering, just shaking from the severe cold. Seamus, you're going to take 1 damage from the intense cold as it cuts through your goblin made clothing, which is not high quality. And right. Seeps into your thin, frail, goblin-like form.
Got it. Noted.
Awesome. So you guys can continue, or you can stop.
We should probably stop before our goblin dies.
Yeah, let's do that.
Yeah, I've only got 4 hit points, so let's...
Oh, you only have 4 hit points?
Yeah.
Yikes.
We should stop.
Yeah, definitely. Definitely.
Okay. Now, Doug, you have the healer's trait.
Yes, I do.
Sure. Which you can use to help him.
All right, let's do that. So I roll 2d6, and if it's 5 or 6, he gets actually 2 hit points, but he can't go above 4, right?
Right.
Correct.
Okay. And I got 2 5s. So.
All right. So the elf lays hands on the goblin.
Hello.
Are you like a doctor, or do you actually have like magic that heals people?
I think I have like magic.
Okay, so you summon deep from the well of your elven mysticism or some crap. I don't know.
Wow.
Well, some crap. It's your game.
Some crap.
It's pretty bad of the game designer. Doesn't even respect your character.
It's a settingless game. We haven't determined what the setting is. Are all elves inherently magical? Fine, all elves are inherently magical. Whatever.
Okay.
You reach into the recesses of your elvenness, and you reach out and touch someone and heal them.
All right, so you're all healed up, Josh. Or Seamus.
There we go. So you folks could continue again. Or you could stop it still.
Are the mounts okay? The mounts okay for the cold? Okay. I forgot to mention I have a beast speaker as a trait. I was going to check in with them.
Oh, they think the the goblin Seamus rides a riding pig.
Nice.
Trained a giant like boar with tusks, basically, right? And. This riding pig is very unhappy that the goblin smells so bad. He smells like fermented berries and nuts, and it's disgusting, and who would eat that crap?
So I'm just constantly chuckling as the pig makes noises, and I'm just like...
Right. The pig. Everybody's like, oh, the pig keeps grunting and oinking as it walks, and inside he's like swearing up a storm, you know?
He's like, I hate my life.
I'm just like, I wish I was bacon.
Yeah.
I'm just like, I like this pig.
All right. The pig's name. We'll have to name the pig now, I guess. We've got to name the pig. What's the pig's name?
Yeah, give me a minute on that. I'll work on it while we play.
Okay.
All right.
What are you drawing?
We'll have to name the pig.
Got to name the pig.
The pig's name is Prius. There we go.
There we go.
Prius.
It's terrible. So the rest of the evening, uneventfully, you manage to reach a forest that you'll be traveling through for the next 2 days, and that provides some semblance of shelter against at least the biting wind. You know, you're off the open road where the wind was just sweeping through you, and now you're at least in some trees. However, one of the trees...
Standing right here.
Right? Can't see the forest for the treant. The tree has fallen across the road as you enter the forest.
Oh no!
A large fir tree, quite big.
Okay, well that seems a little bit unusual.
I didn't know him.
Can anyone detect traps or anything?
Anybody can attempt to find traps. Yeah, you just need to make a test. If you're perceptive, you'll get a bonus.
Okay. Why don't I do that? I'm going to do that. And I got a 5.
Well, there is no trap tied to the fallen tree.
Can we do a test to see if it's a natural fall or if it was placed there?
Yeah, of course. So Seamus is going to go over and inspect the base of the tree.
5.
Okay. Well, it looks like somebody chopped it down.
Yeah, that's what I figured.
So this is not natural, guys.
It's kind of rude to leave a tree in the middle of the road.
I know.
Right?
Probably Cliffstone's cousin. Clingstone's cousin.
Oh, no.
We don't know all the trees.
We don't have meetings. Is that kind of like a... No, I won't go there.
You're a friend. I'll let it go.
The casual speciesism here is just hurting me.
I'm like that one of those friends that says like inappropriate things, and everybody's like, "Okay, we'll let it pass."
And they're kind of like, "Why do we keep him around?"
Yeah, no, that's and this is the story of my life, actually, probably.
I wasn't gonna say
I thought I was that friend.
Okay, well now I was getting sad. So let's move on. Somebody has deliberately felled this tree, blocking your path.
All right.
Does anybody want to do anything?
I would like, because I have sneak. I'd like to sneak around and see if I can spot anyone in the area.
Okay, go for it.
Oh, I got a 5.
Awesome. So you sneak off into the forest to kind of scout the little immediate area around you. So you're moving through the underbrush. It's kind of a pain because this is a thick evergreen forest. So there's like pine needles all over the ground, which actually make it easier to sneak because pine needles are not loud.
Right.
Eventually you get around and there are 4 gnolls crouched on the other side of the tree, hunched down with bows and arrows.
Oh.
Okay, I need to sneak back and let the group know.
No problem.
Roll for it.
No. So you kind of peek out. You see the gnolls. You turn around. You head back, picking your way through the leaves again.
So there were 3 gnolls, correct?
4.
4. So guys, there's 4 gnolls on the other side of this tree.
All right.
Well, I imagine they're going to attack us if we try to go past them.
Right.
So we should probably preempt that.
Let's do it.
Okay. So how are you going to preemptively attack them? What is the plan?
See, I'm also fairly sneaky, so...
Right.
You and I could go in. Go in and try to get around the other side of them.
Yeah, I've got magic bolt, too, so I can shoot from a range.
Yeah, I have to get up and stab them, but...
I can hit them with a bow if I can make it around the other side without being detected.
I just kind of punch things really, really well.
Oh, whoa, whoa. Hi.
Go.
Hi. Everyone's got kids.
We've got dogs and toddlers and cats crashing this whole show.
Wow, I don't even have anybody right now. Oh. I'm so alone.
Hi. I know. Mommy let you out of your kennel.
Yeah, oh, Jordan, you let Owen out of his kennel.
All right, so those of you who are sneaking around, I need you to make a test.
Okay, yep. I did not. I failed that.
Okay.
I got 3 5s.
Okay. I did a 5. Wow. All right, so Amanda made it.
Yes.
Seamus Tim made it. Seamus made it. And did not make it, and then was Clingstone trying to sneak around?
No, it wasn't.
You were just kind of standing there in the road waiting until the fight starts?
Yeah. Pretty much.
Okay. Well, So the elf and the lizard folk and the goblin, they move in, they kind of sneak around the tree. And the lizard folk's like coming out of the, you know, little pine needles stuck in between the scales to like make it like a bush. Kind of exactly, just moving out. And the goblin's readying an arcane blast of energy. Yep. When the elf trips and falls out of the other side of the forest. Sending his bow clattering against the ground. And all the gnolls kind of stop and look at the elf. Everybody kind of does that pause, and they look over there, and they look the other way, and they see the lizard folk now. And with, you know, a furious gnoll-like roar, they charge you all.
Great.
So we're going to roll initiative. The way you do initiative is you just roll 2d6, add the dice together.
Ooh.
I got a 4.
6.
8.
11.
Oh.
Ooh. All right. So, Wootin had an 11. Seamus had a what?
Seamus had a 6.
A 6. And then Klinkstone had the 8, right?
Yes.
And I had the 4.
Yep, I marked you first.
You clumsy elf.
All right, elf, the clumsiest elf ever.
Yeah, pretty much. Right. I'm the anti-elf. That's probably I'm like the Jar Jar Binks of elves.
No.
I am really bothered that you made that reference.
Seriously.
All right, so the elf, all four gnolls automatically go first now, and they eat the elf. Wootend, you're first, actually.
Okay. Well, then I would like to, if I can reach one of them, if I wasn't too far away when we were all discovered, I would like to run up and stab whichever one's closest to me.
Sure. So on your turn, you can take 2 actions. You can use a move to close with one of the gnolls, and then you can make an attack.
All right. That's what I will do.
Awesome. Then go ahead and roll your attack.
It's still just the 2 dice, right?
Yep.
That's like the default.
Are you mastered with the weapon you're using?
Yes, I'm using my dagger.
Nice. That means you get advantage.
Hooray! All right, and I succeeded. I didn't need the extra dice, but I succeeded anyway.
So you damage the gnoll. So you step forward, you know, and with a thrust of your knife, you stab one of the gnolls through its furry side, and it kind of howls in pain, a very hyena-esque owl. Klingstone, you're up.
All right. close the distance between me and the next closest one. And I'm just gonna kind of swing one of my hands down,
to
smack it.
Perfect. And you are you're mastered with unarmed attacks, so you will roll 3 dice.
Right.
And looking for a 5 or 6.
Nope.
All right. So your massive tree-like fist swings down, and the gnolls hear the creaking of wood, and manage to get out of the way as you. You know, the wind rushes past them as your massive fist swings by. The gnolls now get to go. The gnoll that Wootin stabbed is very unhappy about being stabbed.
Sure.
He decidedly did not like that. So he starts frothing at the mouth in almost a rabid sense.
Yeah.
And then lunges with an attack. And I don't have dice. I gotta grab my dice. I just realized that.
Oh, no.
Hang on.
Sorry, guys.
Shall I make comments about his bookshelf while we wait?
Yeah, there we go.
All right, now I have dice. So this gnoll is attacking with disadvantage because he is berserking. Mm-hmm. So he misses. So with a mighty swing, he takes his two-handed stone axe and just takes a cut across. But the lizard folk is too fast and dodges out of the way.
He missed. He missed, so I can use my opportunist
thing,
right?
No. Yes.
All right. So I only get 1 die, but I get to try to stab him back because he missed me. And I fail spectacularly. All
right. So the momentum of your dodge out of the way, unfortunately, made it hard for you to land a convincing blow on the gnoll. Yeah. 2 of the gnolls see the tree folk, and they lunge forward, swinging their axes at the tree folk. Apparently, they feel like lumberjacks today. The first one misses wildly. He trips over the tree that they have felled into the road and actually sprawls out across the ground at the feet of the tree folk. The other one repeats the same. Unfortunately, he's not talented tree jumpers. And they have successfully missed on 3 dice tacks. Last Noel sees the elf laid on the ground and kind of casually saunters on over there with his axe on his shoulders. And like kind of leers at the elf before he makes a massive attack. Oh, that is a hit.
Of course.
And that is 2 damage there, Aaron. Or Ann. However your character says his name.
Ann.
2 damage as the gnoll axe bites deep into your back as you're on the ground.
Great.
Hey, Seamus, it's your turn.
All right. I'll target the one that just hit Ann.
Okay.
With a magic bolt.
Great. So that's 2d6.
2 5s.
Right on. So you send out a blast of energy and it hits the gnoll in the back, sending him stumbling forward. He howls in pain.
I don't feel that bad.
Oh, and now I'm going to go ahead and make another attack because I get 2 actions.
Okay, you can do it again.
Nice.
I got a 6.
That'll do it. So you blast him again and he stumbles forward and the pain redoubles. All right, Ian, it's your turn.
Okay, so
the Irish.
So my bow is on the ground. Is it away from me? I have to go. I have to reach.
You can reach it. That's fine.
I can pick it up.
Oh yeah.
All right. So I can pick it up and aim it at him and fire and that's no problem.
Totally. All right.
So I'm gonna try to shoot him, the one that just shot me in the back or hit me in the back. I'm gonna hit him in the face with my bow.
With an arrow from
your with the arrow, sorry.
Okay. With the bow.
No, just smack him with the bow.
I'm just gonna smack him across the head with my bow. I got 2 5s, so yes, that's a hit.
Perfect. So you kinda roll over on your back and grab an arrow out of the quiver and boom, and catch the gnoll in the face and he reels back, dropping the axe, clutching at the arrow that's like protruding, you know, through his jaw and out the top of his head, trying to pull it out. Before he slumps, to the ground dead.
Nice,
awesome.
All right, that's the end of the order. So we're back at the top, which is Wu Tint.
All right, so I still have that gnoll in front of me, don't I?
Yeah, the frothing rabid one.
The frothing rabid one who's trying to kill me. Yes, well, I'm still gonna try to kill him back. So
seems like the best plan.
I mean, he's right there, and I rolled nothing. I roll so much nothing.
Well, you're next up, so you can make a second attack with your action.
Oh, that's right. Okay, so I'm gonna try to do that. Okay, this time I actually succeed.
All right, so you lunge forward, and he leaps out of the way, and he does that hyena laugh, you know, the really high-pitched, creepy one. And then you're like, that's really – and then you stab him in the stomach, and he's like, ah! All right.
That's enough of that.
Klingstone.
Okay. I'm going to pick up the dead gnoll by the arrow sticking out of his head and swing it as an improvised weapon at one of the two gnolls that tried to attack me but tripped over their own tree.
So okay.
I'm going to use my Where was it? My martial artist trait I use focus as a free action.
Okay.
So that gives me.
Now with improvised weapons, you're only proficient with them. You're not mastered in them.
Right.
So you get 2 dice, okay. But because you get the free focus, you succeed on a 4, 5, or 6 this time.
All right. Cool. So 2d6.
Yep. 2d6. Looking for a 4, 5, or 6.
I got a 5 and a 6.
You pick up the gnoll and. Just hit another note. There's like a scream and kind of a sickening, squishy, crunchy sound. And yes. Hang on. And Wu Tind is sprayed with gnoll bits.
No!
From the dead gnoll. You didn't kill the one that was on the ground, but the dead one's kind of just splattered everywhere.
Sorry, not sorry.
I'm sorry, but what is wrong with Amanda's character always getting splattered with body parts?
That is true.
I just happen to be in the wrong place every time.
The gnoll that was fighting with Wu-Tin pulls back and unleashes two massive blows with their axe. Oof, one hits and the other one misses. So on the first swing, Wu-Tin, your shoulder gets clipped. You take 2 damage from this blow.
Oh, goodness.
And then on the back swing, you manage to get out of the way.
What do you want, cottage cheese?
Right, so...
And then, go ahead.
Okay. Oh, since he missed with the second attack, would I still be able to do the opportunist, or does it not count because he made one successful one?
Nope.
Okay. All right, then I'm going to try to... All right, I'll try to stab him back. And this time I do!
Okay. Nice! So, you grab your dagger out of his stomach and ram it up into the sternum of his chest, and he kind of slumps over the dagger. And, like, kind of the foul, gnollish breath of rotten meat that, he has kind of exhales into your lizardy face for a minute. And then he slumps over dead.
Ow.
The two that are next to Clingstone are gonna swing at Clingstone, who has left the room. Which means I auto hit, right? If he's not at his table.
Usually.
Oh, there he is. Alright. Clingstone. You will suffer 4 damage as the gnolls just repeatedly hack into you.
Crap.
4 damage. With their axes, they're just going to town like you're a stationary tree.
Oh, stop it.
Their wood chips splatter all over Amanda's character.
and they're sticking because the gore is like holding them on. Right.
Yeah. It's just awful.
Stop mulching me.
All right, so we are.
I'm still relatively okay.
All right, so I'm going to target one of the two that are attacking Clingstone.
Okay.
Thanks.
Hey, Clingstone, how many hit points do you have?
I have 4.
Oh,
and 4 left.
You have 4 left. Okay, so you are 8.
Yeah. No, I have 5 left. Sorry, I was. I had told 9.
Okay.
Okay.
So 5 6 left. And a 3.
All right, that'll hit.
And so
blast one with energy,
Nice.
And then your second attack.
Yep. I miss.
All right, so you hit them, and the gnoll kind of staggers to the side and gives you an obscene gnollish gesture. Yeah. And then ducks as your other arcane bolt fires off into the woods.
Of course.
And...
So I guess I'm going to take a shot at one of the gnolls that's chopping Clingstone down.
Okay.
I'm going to.
Are you targeting a particular one? Are you just targeting one at random?
Just one at random. It's fine. He's got 2 on him, right?
Yep.
So I'll just go for one of them, I guess. And I got a 6, so.
Awesome. So you quickly land an arrow in the back of one of the gnolls, and he staggers forward and turns around and hisses at you.
Nice.
Your second action?
I guess I'll just do it again.
Okay.
And I got another 6.
All right. And as he's hissing at you, you stick another arrow right in his mouth.
Nice.
How's that taste? Just grabbing at it, and then falls over.
Nice. 2 headshots. I'm just going to tell you guys. Look at that.
You might not be able to sneak, but he can apparently use a bow.
That's right.
All right. Wu-Tin, you're up.
Okay. So now I guess I would have to move to get closer to... How many we have left? Just one?
Just the one that's fighting
right.
The...
Right. Okay. Well, then I will move up and stab that guy. That'll be
so you vault over the tree that separates you from him, the fallen tree, and then you stab out.
Yes. Yeah. And I succeed. Got
all
5.
Right. So he's busy, trying to hack at the tree, and you leap forward over the tree and stab him in the back, and the tree folk, gives you a thumbs up or something. I don't know what tree folk do to say thanks. and then old yell, he's reaching around his back trying to grab the blade that you've if it was a human, it'd be a kidney. You're not sure where gnolls have kidneys, or if gnolls have kidneys. It's all very confusing.
I mean, maybe, but something important is probably in that area.
Yeah. Seems legit. Klingstone, you're up.
All right, I'm going to turn to face the remaining gnoll that's been stabbing me, and just gonna swing a branch down and punch it in the face.
All right,
unarmed strike. I'm proficient.
Great.
Or mastery of that. So is that three? I forget.
Yep. If you're mastered, you get three.
Five, four, three. Yep.
Perfect. So you had a five?
Yep.
So you boom, and there's kind of a splattering sound as you make a gnoll pancake.
Does it splatter onto Wootend?
Right there, I mean.
She is right next to it, so yeah.
Yeah. Nice.
I pick out my fist. Is this your knife?
Yeah, thanks. Thanks for that.
It was like bone splinters from the gnoll's like rib cage in your hand.
Spartan.
That was a brutally violent encounter. Holy cow.
is there a swamp nearby somewhere I can wash off?
If you could probably find a stream in the forest if you looked for one.
Nice.
Yeah, but I mean, swamp water's just got that extra something.
Yeah, that's not just as that's almost as bad as being covered in that stuff already.
No. Swamp water's where it's at.
You can find a sort of marshy area of the forest. Yeah.
Yeah. Okay. Since I used arrows, we were talking about this a little bit in the chat beforehand. Since I used some of the arrows, I have to roll for to see if any of them are not good anymore.
Right. So you're going to make a test. You're going to roll 2d6.
All right. And if any of them come up ones, I deplete.
No. So you're thinking the depletion mechanic.
Oh, okay. That's what I'm thinking.
The cinematic ammo mechanic is at the end of every fight, if you use a ranged weapon, like a non-magical ranged weapon, you just make a test. If you don't succeed, you're out of arrows.
Wait a minute. Okay.
Oh, no.
I got a five, so that's good.
You still have arrows. Look at that.
One and a five, so that's good. Okay.
You can replenish You can replenish your ammo if you have time to rest or make more arrows. This is not. Oh, it just means you're like out for the fight.
You can take some from the chunks that they took off of me.
There you go.
Nice. Now, should
we have a willing trait?
should we start healing people up? I mean, because poor Klingstone's like kind of like a half life here.
Unfortunately, you can't heal me. I just have to stand in the sun for a couple hours. Or sleep.
Well, why don't we rest for a couple hours?
Yeah, let's do that.
Tree folk can't be healed by magic.
Oh.
Did anyone else get hit? I didn't get hit.
I did get hit, so I guess I could heal myself.
Touch yourself?
Everyone look away.
That's not that type of game.
Get your mind out of the gutter.
Wow.
Anyway, so poor Alan. This is the type of game that we have on this channel.
I need to revise that live stream stretch goal I did.
Yeah, exactly.
Make it something else.
I really want to be stuck with these people.
12 months.
12 months. What did I agree to?
I get for doing something without full information.
So how does healing work? Do you regain health as well?
So if you sleep, for every hour of sleep, you get one hit point back.
Oh, okay.
Or if you sleep for 6 hours, you get them all back.
Okay.
Which in the case of most of you, 6 hours is how many hit points you have. Right. For, our tree folk friend, though, that does matter.
Yeah, he has to basically go into a coma in order to get his life back.
If I get the full 6 hours, I'll get
he'll get them all back.
My health back. Or for every hour, I'm walking in sunlight or standing in sunlight.
Okay.
So I can just go for a jog. If it's sunny out.
So it is. I mean, it was. Now you're in the forest, so it's not so much.
So it's not so funny now. So what do you guys think? Should we just rest for a little while and heal up? Or, I mean, you guys...
Let's rest and have a pint.
Probably not a bad idea.
That's what you always say, Seamus.
You know, I'm fond of the drink. I told you that in the beginning.
All right, so let's make camp for a little bit.
All right, so you guys make camp for the night.
I just kind of like scoop over all the bits that they chopped off of me and put it in a pile, then you guys can light it on fire.
Well, that seems wrong somehow. That's
very morbid.
My contribution.
You're very loose with what happens to the bits of you that people cut off during fights.
Well, I can't.
That's fine.
I can't put it back on, right?
I guess it's true. I might as well go to you somehow.
All right. Well, you morbidly burn chunks of your friend that were chopped off, I guess, to provide some level of warmth.
I'm okay.
Great. So the night passes rather uneventfully. You all kind of hunker down and huddle up against the cold for the evening. Morning comes, and you know the birds are quietly chirping. And you know, it kind of smells.
They're arguing about stuff.
Kind of smells like rotting knoll.
Lovely.
I don't smell nothing.
Yeah, that's because you smell just as bad, Seamus.
Probably, you're right.
All right, so
that was a full 6, right?
Yeah, that? So that's a full 6 hours. Yeah. Everybody will heal.
Okay. Yeah, we'll all heal.
Yay. Okay. Sorry.
Nope, you're good. No worries. So, what's the plan? Are you going to continue on towards the thought crypt?
Let's keep going to So, do we have to do another save test?
Nope. Now that you're in the forest, you're sheltered enough from the elements. You're okay.
Okay.
Cool. You're able to make pretty good time. This day passes fairly uneventfully.
Nice.
So, you make camp for the night, which again passes uneventfully, and halfway through the third day, you arrive at the outskirts of the thaw crypt. So before you, there's this part of the forest, a clearing in the middle of the forest here. And it's probably 300 yards in diameter. It's a good size clearing in the middle of this forest. And there's a massive stone mound that it looks like somebody just piled rocks on top of each other until it stands about 6 stories high.
Wow.
And it is covered in a thick sheen of 6-inch thick ice that reflects the sun. The ice appears to be slowly melting, so you can see little rivulets of water running down. If you look at it too long, it starts to hurt your eyes because of the reflecting light and the rainbow crescendo that flies out off the water and ice. But you can see an entrance there that leads into what you can only assume is the thaw crypt.
All right.
Shall we?
That's why we came here. How else are we going to get our 30 gold each?
Okay. So, Hi, did you have a good walk? Yeah, okay. So you guys head on into the thought crypt, moving forward. The ground as you walk towards there, this clearing is kind of wet and spongy. You sink about an inch every step you take into the ground. At one point, Seamus, you look down, and you're not sure if it's because you've been drinking or if it's because, you know, this is what you're seeing. But it looks like there's like skulls and bones kind of under a thin layer of dirt that you're actually walking on what appears to be a bed of bones.
I'm not sure if I'm seeing this right, but it looks like the skulls and bones around here.
Yeah, kind of does.
Why that?
What do you guys suppose that means?
Well, I mean, it is a crypt.
Yeah, do you suppose that means?
It probably means that people have died clinging stone. I'm just guessing. I don't know.
I mean, to be fair, Clinkstone doesn't have a skeleton. He has no concept of this.
This is true. This is true.
He just sort of either rots or burns up.
Oh. Or petrifies.
Or petrifies. That's or, exactly there you what go.
Go. Yeah. There you go.
So, I guess this one just that this isn't natural ground that we're walking on. Is there? Can I check to see?
Yeah, you can make a test. Yeah, that's fine.
I got a 5 and a 5.
Awesome. So, yeah, you kind of poke, or you take your shillelagh and kind of poke at the ground as he was going. And it appears like, as you kind of, the more you move stuff around, you're kind of, this layer of bone that this thing is built on, or whatever you're walking on, goes several feet deep. You actually can't find the end. It's got a thin layer of dirt and gunk on top that appears to provide the ground you're walking on.
That's gross.
Are you guys seeing this?
So it's like a sea of bone.
Indeed.
I still don't get it.
Shibis, you're pretty sure one of them is looking at you. It's kind of got this lopsided grin.
We should keep moving.
Yeah, let's book it. Let's
do this as quickly as we can. This place is creepy.
All right, let's move.
So can we run?
Yeah, of course you can run. So everybody needs to make me a test at disadvantage as you run.
So you only get one
dice.
Try not to fall.
2.
Three.
So Seamus, you passed?
Seamus did not pass.
Okay. Who passed? Nobody passed.
No one.
Okay.
No one.
Okay. So you all start to run, and you know, and you quickly realize running across just a pile of bone is basically like trying to run through mud or quicksand, because the bone keeps shifting every step you take, and you start sliding around trying to keep your balance as you're running, and at a couple points you fall or land on a knee or something, and like skeletal hands reach up and try to grab you and drag you under the sea of bones.
Okay.
Trying to bat free. All of you take 1 damage as you make some headway towards the entrance.
Curses. Okay, I guess running was not such a great plan.
Well,
then let's just not dilly-dally.
Yeah, it could have been a lot worse, though. I have a feeling if we had taken our time, I think we would have ended up a lot worse than just with 1 hit point.
You're about halfway to the entrance of the Thought Crypt, and a massive mound of the ground starts to move up into some sort of bone elemental thing.
Yeah.
To build up, and it actually looks like the ground is rolling towards you in waves of bones.
Oh, God, that's horrifying.
So, limbs and rib cages and skulls tumble head over, bony heel.
This is like
this tidal wave of bone kind of crests up towards you. What are you guys going to do?
What are we going to do?
Can we try running again?
Can we try running again?
It didn't seem to work very well.
No, it did not.
Well, I do have a mastery in Tai Chi, so maybe we just roll with it.
Everybody cling to you and just roll with it. Oh, goodness.
I think we lost Jordan.
Jeez.
Let's see here. What should we do?
What is this that's happening? Is this some kind of sentient being? Can we talk to it?
You can try. Would you like to roll a test for some sort of diplomacy?
I mean, is there a face or something?
There's not a face.
Well, yeah, Clingstone, you have the beast talking thing. Maybe you'll have better luck. I don't know if it's a beast or what it is. I don't know.
Hi, bone wave.
And this tidal wave of, skeletal death and destruction comes cresting over the tree folk who's like standing in front of it going like this.
Doesn't seem to be stopping.
It kind of stops and pauses, And a single skull with a vertebrae kind of like comes out, snaking its way out.
Ooh.
And the mouth kind of flops open.
Hi.
Who disturbs the guardian of the Thaw Crypt?
Oh. We do.
Sorry. Give them our names. Introduce us.
Clickstone. Tell them who we are.
I am Clingstone of the Tree Folk. This is Wootent. Sorry,
yeah,
actually,
Wootent. Yeah.
Wootent of the Lizard Folk. That is Seamus of Goblinkin, and that's Aeon of the Elven Realm. We were sent here to retrieve the, what was the sword called?
Iron Thorn?
The Iron Thorn Blade.
We were asked to retrieve the Iron Thorn Blade.
And the head kind of sneaks around and looks at each of you in turn. Has the Lord judged you worthy to enter his crypt?
My Lord.
Hang on. we are uncertain if we have met this Lord of the Crypt. Could you introduce us?
So cute.
The head like looks around and disappears back into the wave of bones that's just sitting there, kind of hovering over you with a impending sense of, you know, doom.
Doom, Odie. Doom.
And it comes back out a few minutes later. And it kind of looks at you all and it... I don't know what to do with you.
We get that a lot.
You're not supposed to be here.
Why don't you just let us through, man?
You're going to steal a magic sword from my crypt.
Come on, get to know us. Have a pint with us.
Steal is such a strong word.
We're just going to borrow it.
Yeah, he says that we'll bring it right back.
But we're stealing it. Who does it belong to that we're stealing it from? I feel like I'm missing something here.
He belongs to my lord, the one who built this crypt.
Bye.
Who is your lord?
And then kind of like, you come to invade the tomb of an individual you do not know? It seems like incredulous that you can even do this.
But we're new here.
It kind of, as much as a, you know, a fleshless, muscleless skull can make a face of you know, kind of incredulous shock, it does that. This is the tomb of the great lich, Kel'Thuzar.
That freaking dwarf.
I knew this wasn't going to be easy.
Yeah. I think we were kept out of the loop on some things on this.
Next time, we got to ask better questions.
Yeah, clearly.
Or at the very least, money up front.
half up front, half on delivery. That's what we should. We need to really kind of...
We should have negotiated for more.
We need to institute that policy.
That's right. Yeah, definitely.
All right. Well, we can have this business meeting some other time.
That's true.
All right. Obviously this belongs to your master, this sword. Is there anything he'd be willing to exchange, perhaps, to part with it?
Do we wish to ask a lich if he will exchange magic items from his tomb?
Yeah.
Well, I mean...
Okay, when you put it like that, it sounds dumb.
Yes, we're here. We can ask questions at least. I don't know.
We do have this really cool tree folk that we can kind of make for fire that provides a lot of fire.
Trade a member of our party.
Did I say that out loud? I'm sorry. I didn't realize that I said that.
We also have the world's clumsiest elf.
Me's not clumsy.
Oh, no.
Oh, God. This cursed copyright infringement. Doesn't know what to do.
Neither did we when we saw episode one either.
A few minutes later, the bone wave kind of recedes and just settles back to their ground.
He's like, I've had enough of this. These guys are doomed anyway.
We succeed with the power of confusion and annoyance.
And a actual path, a bridge of stone comes up that leads to the entrance of the crypt that you can walk on safely.
Wow, that's very... That's fortunate. They
have just totally inadvertently completely screwed us over, guys. They might try to eat us if we go in there. Just saying.
Yeah, that's true. That's not good. They know what we're after already.
But I mean, we've come all this way.
Yeah.
They don't. They also at least know we're kind of agreeable.
And we said we were gonna get this. We said we were gonna try to get this sword. So.
That's true. That's true. Yeah.
We got there. The crypt was creepy. We came home.
You know what? No bang. We're really tame adventurers. First sign of actual trouble. Now we're good.
No, we're good. We're good.
We're gonna go home.
Yeah. No. All right, let's go across this bridge.
Sally forth into certain doom.
Yeah, sure.
All right, so you guys move across the bridge. And as you approach the entrance to the Thaw Crypt, there's a figure standing there in robes leaning on a massive ebony staff.
Mm. Hello. Should we approach him? Should we...
I mean, the path's not that wide. I think we're going to have to talk to him.
Yeah, I think we're probably going to have to.
Go for it, Clingstone.
Yeah, Clingstone, you've been pretty good at this so far.
For God's sake.
No, he hasn't.
I got it to talk. That's about as much as I could accomplish.
So, Clingstone, what do you say to the cloaked figure?
Rolling behind him.
Hi, I don't know how much of that previous exchange you heard, but these are my friends. Kind of. And we're here looking for a sword. What's your name?
Wow.
This is great.
So the rogue figure kind of looks at you. Perhaps there's somebody else in the group with the vocal fortitude to address me in the appropriate manner.
You're up, elf.
Oh my god.
Hey, we're looking for entrance to the tomb. May we pass?
You have found the entrance. If you are still looking, you were not looking very well.
Maybe we pass. Are you going to stop us?
I can't stop you. I'm simply a shade.
Oh.
What lies beyond the tomb here? The entrance?
Death and destruction and terrors untold.
Oh, great.
And lots of treasure.
You got the wall of bone. We're screwed.
Oh, but no.
All right, so let's
go through. This guy don't know what he's talking about.
I'm pretty sure he lives here. He probably does know what he's talking about.
He kind of probably does, Seamus.
Goblin, I would suggest you stick to your wine and not treat the word of Kalthazar so lightly.
You're Kalthazar.
I am the shade of Kalthazar.
Oh, well, nice to meet you.
Shade, shadow, y'all look alike.
Please forgive my goblin friend. He's drunk.
Well.
Perpetually.
I understand you've come to steal my sword.
Again, steal is a strong word.
Is it the right word?
Maybe? The terms of our employment are unclear, we're finding out.
Perhaps I can offer you different employment.
What might that be?
Yeah.
I will give you the sword you seek in exchange for small favors to be called in later.
Oh dear.
Like firewood? Like
everybody wants something.
What kind of favors?
Yeah.
Favors suited to your individual and particular skill sets. For example, if I have a glass, if I have a cask of terrible wine, I need drunk, I will call the goblin.
Wait, yeah, but I mean, like evil favors or just stuff you need us to do because you're not
evil. Evil is a matter of perspective.
Wow.
For example, I could argue that it's evil to come into my house and attempt to steal my sword.
Touche.
This is true.
Hold on, I think we need to conference.
Yeah, let's all huddle up there.
Well, give us a second. We'll be right
back.
We'll
be right back with you. Yeah. So what do you guys think?
I just kind of lean over everybody.
I'm gonna look up.
We're conferencing in the shade of Plainstone.
What do we think? What do we think?
Sounds like one of those scenarios where you do something for me. Like, you have to go do, I don't know. Yeah.
I think I'm almost afraid he's going to ask us to bring back Gutter Drunk's head or something.
I'm okay with that.
Yeah, that's all right.
I mean, we get the sword first, then we get paid, then we cut off his head, and then bring it back. Everybody wins. Fine.
I mean, I'm just concerned. I'm just more concerned if he's like, okay.
We don't want to do anything evil. That's on the table.
Murdering seedy barkeeps is one thing. Like burning down orphanages is another. All right. That's. But also, I want actual terms from this guy, as in how many favors.
Yeah.
How long is this employ? I don't want to be like forking over my immortal soul here.
This is true. This is true.
So ask more questions, which we didn't do in the beginning.
See, we should.
We're learning from our mistakes.
There we go. Okay, let's go. We should ask him the details of the favors.
Well, doesn't necessarily know what favors he wants yet. Just how many favors are we doing for him, and how long are we bound to this agreement?
He said at least one for each of us is pretty much what I kind of got from
original. Want that clarified?
Yeah, let's go back to
standard undead king contract. Yeah,
yeah.
Wooten's on a roll. Why don't we have Wooten talk to him?
Yeah, Wooten. That's
must I? All right.
Yeah, I'm tired.
This is too much talking. Done.
I'm an ent. I'm basically an ent. I've talked way too fast today.
All right, we're gonna
patiently waiting.
Approach the shade again.
You first.
Okay, so we're considering your proposal. How long would we be bound to carry out your favors, or how many favors are you talking about here?
Intelligent questions, both quantity and quality. I'm sure we can find something mutually agreeable. Why don't we say three favors each?
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 Or like as a group?
No, individually each. But you'll have the right to refuse them if you don't want to do them.
Oh, okay. I mean, that's better. And then once those three favors are complete,
your obligation to me is ended.
And there's no.
Yeah, you were never not free. You simply.
There's no. I get to eat your soul. Footnote.
For your soul. I mean,
Can I have my lawyers?
Good if you really want, but that seems.
I'm just clarifying here.
We're going to be
going to taste very good.
We're going to be physically and spiritually intact after all of this, I guess, is our concern.
Allow me to clarify then. Okay. I will take no action that would damage your physical, spiritual, or mental well-being.
Okay.
To if you come out of the favor spiritually and physically intact, I can't promise that.
That's on us.
Your own aptitude or ineptitude will determine that for you.
Hmm. Excuse us a second. Back to the other side.
Yeah, let's go back.
I don't know. What do you guys think?
I say we just go in there and we just take him out.
How do you take out a lich? What are you gonna do?
I don't know.
We can't trip over a branch and fall again.
That's true. Yeah, no, it's. I'll try not to do that.
We could trip over a pile of bones, however.
This is true.
Don't do that.
Yeah, right. Don't do that. So, what does everyone think?
I don't know. I don't trust this. I don't trust this deal.
Well, yeah, that's three things each.
Yeah, that's 12 favors. That's a lot.
Yeah.
But I mean, we don't necessarily have to wait around while this doesn't necessarily have to be like a thing where we're just standing here waiting for him to give us favors. I imagine he can contact us. We can still carry on adventuring.
What if we get the sword up front?
Well, no, I think that was the deal. We get the sword now and do favors later, right? Right?
Yep. Yeah, that's that was the deal.
Oh, okay.
So we get the sword. We each owe him three favors.
We talk him down to two.
More negotiating.
That's what our group is great at.
hey, we got our 30 gold.
That's
maybe,
true.
If we get out of here alive.
You're welcome.
All right. Well, we either negotiate or go with. Ian's plan to just go in there, go for it.
I don't feel that will end well.
No, I don't think it will end well either. Let's counter offer.
Okay.
Two favors.
Three. Let's do one favor each. Let's go back to one favor each.
All right. You make this proposal there, Ian.
All right. Let's Kalthazar.
Yes.
Hey, Kalthazar. Hey, what's going on? Hey, so I haven't really. I'm Ian. I'm kind of a clumsy elf. But,
you're also very flippant in how you address your betters.
What's that? Oh, you're sorry. Very
flippant in how you address your
betters. Yeah. Well, I'm sorry. I'm kind of. Yeah. Once you get to know me, you'll understand that. That's how I am.
We really need a bard.
So Kalthazar, we appreciate you making this offer to us and all that, but we really think that the three favor thing is just way too high. We'll do it for one favor each. We'll take that sword off your hands. You're not doing anything with that sword anyway.
Are you a union steward?
Very well. One favor each. Acceptable.
Wow. Okay. Favor each.
Are we good?
If you feel we are good, I am agreeable to these terms.
I feel kind of dirty now, though. Why is that? I don't.
You're not on a street corner. You're in a tomb.
Yeah, no.
This is fine. This is normal adventuring stuff. Come on.
Okay. All right. All right. So where's this? So we'll do one favor each. What's this? I mean, we can refuse it at any. We can refuse any favor, right? as long as we do one favor?
Of course, you'll simply... Yes, you can refuse any favor you don't wish to do.
Oh.
Okay.
Option of favor.
We're all set with that?
I'm set.
I think this sounds agreeable.
All right, let's hand that sword over.
And sword appears in his hands, and he hands it to you.
Hey,
can we check to make sure it's the real deal?
It matches the picture.
Oh, we had a picture. That's right.
Yeah, we got a picture on the map.
Yeah, it matches the illustration. And if you hold it, it feels physical. You can swing it. It'll make. I mean, it's a sword.
It's pointy.
Yep, it pointy and goes in the other dude. It works.
Can I put it up to my face and like say like. See sight upon sight or sight beyond sight. And...
Yeah, everybody thinks you look like an idiot, but you know.
Nice, nice.
What are you doing?
I saw this once. It was really cool.
It's not. It's not okay. Cool.
Sorry. Nobody else thinks it's cool.
Yeah, no.
The elf of copyright infringement.
All right. So yeah. Kalthazar, pleasure doing business with you.
Indeed. I look forward to collecting my favors at a mutually agreeable time.
Sounds great. I imagine you'll send us a bat or something. Okay.
You'll be aware.
Okay, I figured.
Text message?
Out of curiosity, have any of you actually read like book 4 of the Dresden Files?
No.
Which one's 4?
Summer Night?
What happens? Yes! Yes.
you just made the deal Harry makes with Mab in that book.
Yeah, that's kind of what I was thinking about while this was happening. That's fine. Nothing bad will happen. Right. It's fine. Right. It's fine, guys.
Yeah, there's how, like, there's oh, how many
I can, books I can refuse, and then she's like, if you refuse, I'll kill your sister.
Wait, what?
Great.
Yeah.
Deals are bad. Anyway, so now you have to head back out.
All right, so we make it across this bone ocean.
You exit safely.
Nice.
However, it is pouring snow.
Oh, sweet.
Okay.
All of you make a test for me. This is a perception test. So if you're perceptive, you will get the bonus.
I have a 6.
Ooh, 6. Nice.
Nope.
After about an hour, okay, those of you who succeeded, after about an hour of travel back down the road, you realize you're being followed.
Oh.
Yeah, great.
All right. Can I sneak around and see if I can see who it is?
Sure. Roll a stealth.
And that's advantage. Yes, got a 5. 5 to 2 is awesome. 1.
Side note, we just crossed 55K on the Kickstarter.
Woo!
Woo! Woo!
Yes!
Yay!
Hey!
All right, so, so you sneak back to see what's following you. And there is a massive white-colored, like, kind of albino spider, like the size of a draft horse.
Okay. Oh, wow.
All right, I got to go back and alert the others. Okay. Guys, there's this giant freaking white spider. I mean, huge. I mean, I'm small. He's tall. This thing is like somewhere in between.
Nice.
So it's a riding spider for me.
Precisely.
Yeah.
Should we go back out? Should we go back and take care of it?
No, I say we wait here and make it come to us. That way, it'll be tired.
We could all take hiding positions.
Right.
Okay. Let's
try
do
to
that.
Jump out at the spider.
Let's hide and wait for it.
And so you all obscure yourselves?
Yes.
Yes.
All right. So this it's snowing. The spider is white. You're gonna have to make perception test to find it as it tries to sneak up on you.
Oh no.
Five. So, Klingstone got it?
Yep.
Anybody else?
Yep.
Okay, great. So, Klingstone and Seamus, you see the spider deftly moving across the tops of the trees. So he looks like everybody was watching the ground, and conveniently, you two managed to remember that spiders can climb things really well. And you happen to look up in time to see the massive spider sneaking up on you from above.
Can I shoot a magic bolt at it?
Sure. Let's roll initiative.
Hey.
Oh, giant spider is probably going first.
I got a
9. All right, so hang on. Aang got a 9?
Yep.
Okay. Who got an 8?
I did.
Seamus?
I also got an 8.
Okay. And Wootend? Klingstone, what did you get?
7.
All right, well, yes, the spider is going first. So the spider drops down from the trees above you, and it lands on Seamus.
Of course.
Oh no!
And it bites down with its pincers, attempting to poison you. Ooh, it'll hit. Now you have your goblin agility advantage.
Yes, I do.
So because you were hit, you can just roll a d6 on a 5 or 6. The attack misses.
It's a 5.
So you manage to duck and roll out of the way as these massive mandibles jab into the ground, trying to get you. All right. His next action will be to spit web at Klingstone. Klingstone, you need to make a save test.
Okay. That's a 2?
Yep, just 2d6. Looking for a 5 or 6.
5. Got it.
All right, awesome. So you managed to break the webbing before it ties you down.
Sweet.
Aang, you're up.
All right, so I'm going to aim and shoot him with my – shoot him in the – how is he facing? Is he facing
He's facing all of you, kind of.
So I can try to shoot him –
Technically, his back is to me, I would think.
Yeah.
All right. So I'm just gonna take my bow out, and I'm going to aim for him and shoot him right in the – hopefully – somewhere in the head, maybe in one of his 8 eyes. I'm assuming he has 8 eyes.
Yeah.
All right, let's do that. We'll try to aim for one of the eyes. I got 2 6s. Oh wait, I should have had three, but that's all right.
All right, so you hit him and you feather an arrow into his eye.
Nice. Now I get to go again.
Yep, you get another action.
Let's do that again.
Okay.
And that's two. Oh wait, I'm supposed to roll 3. Nope, that's all 3s. So no, that's
all right, your other arrow goes wide farther into the forest.
Oh great.
All right. Seamus and Wootend, you're both up. You can decide how you want to figure that out.
Go ahead, Wootend.
All right, well, I'm just going to try to stab him. Am I close enough to do that, or do I have to move up first?
You have to move up and stab him.
All right, then I shall move up and stab him.
All right, roll the stab.
I rolled nothing.
No.
All right. So
much nothing.
Somehow you missed the giant 8-legged spider with your melee weapon. It's a very agile spider. He does a backflip out of the way and like lands on 2 legs with 6 legs gesturing to come at him or something. He's a kung fu spider. All right. Next is Seamus.
Seamus. Gonna blast him with a bolt of energy. I got 2 5s.
Great. Well, that'll hit him. So you zap him with a bolt of energy.
And we shall do it again.
All right.
6.
Okay. And you hit him again. So the spider screams in pain, and his snow white carapace turns singed and black and brown where you've blasted him with arcane energy.
Awesome.
All right. Next is Klingstone.
Am I within kicking distance? Because he just started shivering. Okay, I'm just gonna try to punt him in the just punt him in the bag.
Okay, kick the spider. Roll.
Okay, that's three. Okay, I got 85.
Nice. So you you reach out and kick, connecting with the spider, and cracks shoot through his chitinous carapace.
Nice. All right, and I get to go you down. All right. I'm gonna follow through. I just kind of like from the kick spin and just kind of elbow him in the back.
All right. The Kung Fu Tree person does a spinning kick followed up by a flying elbow attack.
Nice. I like it.
I'm waiting for five and a six. I'm waiting for you to go for the chair.
I got a five and a six. The tree
just pulls a chair out of somewhere in the forest and hits him. All right. Yeah, five and six will do it. So you bring your elbow down on his thorax, and there's another cracking sound, and this time ichor and gunk spray everywhere.
Nice.
Does it go on Wooten?
No, not this. He's gotten smarter. Wooten's gotten smarter about getting out of the way of the gunk.
Yeah. I am really violent for a tree.
Yeah. You're the world's most violent tree.
Yeah.
All right, so the spider bites down hard at the goblin. Ooh, it hits. You need to roll the goblin agility.
No, misses.
Okay, so you take one damage as the mandibles chomp down hard on you. And then you need to make a save test against poison.
Uh-oh.
Is that 2d6?
Yep.
I got a 6.
Nice. You you can feel the burning venom through your body, but you manage to shrug it off and keep going. His other action is to spray web at the tree again. You need to make a save test for me, tree.
Okay. Nope.
All right. This time, unfortunately, you can't get out of the way or break the webbing, and you're covered in the sticky ichor of web and gunk, and you only get one action next turn.
Okay.
All right. Next is Ian.
Okay. So I'm going to take my bow. Can how much of the thorax and all that has been cracked? You said that he's kind of cracked in places.
Yeah. It's there's not an easy. You don't have like an easy shot to something on the inside.
Okay.
It just looks like it's been damaged.
All right. So I'm going to try to shoot for another. Just shoot at its head again.
Okay.
And I got a 6 and 2 4s.
All right, so you fire another arrow into its base.
Its base.
And nice. It rears back, you know, legs thrashing. And then it kind of rolls onto its back and curls up, and its legs kind of curl in.
Copper cut, grumpy.
Wow.
Did it just kill it?
I think we just killed it. I don't know if we killed it or if it's... It could be... I don't think we've killed it.
Faking. I'm going to step on its head.
Well, okay, you're gonna step. Well, wait. Let me. What should I do? I'm gonna shoot it again just to make sure.
Go ahead.
And I got a 5 and 2 3s. You
put another arrow into this thing, and the body kind of twitches.
So it's still moving. So.
Next is Seamus, and Wootind.
Wooten, go stab it.
You know, I'll try to stab it, but apparently that didn't work so well last time. Well, now it's lying curled up on the ground, so maybe I'll actually be able to stab it.
You don't need to roll. You can just walk up there and stab it.
just stab it in the eye and
Gunky ichor stuff sprays everywhere.
Yeah, of course it does.
Again. Okay.
Yeah, nice.
All right. Seamus, do you want to do anything?
Can we search the body? Can we search it?
I would.
Sure.
Is it wearing a little spider fanny pack? What are we going to find on the giant spider?
I don't know, silk? Can we get silk or something out of it?
You could like, take its poison glands or something, yeah.
Yeah, that's what I'm thinking.
I was going to say, as an alchemist, can I take its poison?
Ooh. That's a good point.
Yeah, you could take its poison and make some poison.
Mm. Now,
I will do that.
Okay, you don't need to roll. You just take some time and you remove these poison glands and you safely store them in a pouch.
Now, right, is...
Two. Dose.
Is Seamus still poisoned or no?
I never got poisoned.
Oh, you never got poisoned? Okay.
Yeah, yep, he made it safe.
All right. So, yeah. I guess, Clingstone, are you still all entangled? Do you want to get untangled?
Yeah, I take my time and just kind of peel it off. I start crocheting it.
Does anybody need to be healed?
Sweater.
If I need to be healed, or we could, you can either heal me and we can move on, or we could take a couple hours rest. Nobody else took damage, right?
No.
I still have one hit point from earlier.
Yeah. Right. Yeah. I would say since it's a blizzarding, we should try to press on.
Yeah. I can try to heal you though.
Yeah, touch me.
All right, let me give it a shot. I got five, good. Two, so you should be healed two hit points.
Feels good, thank you.
That's so wrong. I don't
touch me right.
No. No.
What? No. You healed my wounds.
Oh, thank you.
Oh jeez.
All right, so you guys continue traveling through the forest. Hey, that's my alcohol. You don't want that.
Or do I?
Well, she probably does, but she shouldn't have.
Tiny Dungeon, second edition, brought to you by Dog Booze.
So you guys continue traveling out of the forest. And as you reach the same place where you were ambushed by the gnolls, the tree has been cleared. It's no longer there.
Oh.
And hey, guys, look. There's still some bits of gnoll here. memories.
And there is a small contingent, roughly, 25 or so, dwarf mercenaries with crossbows aimed at you as you exit the forest. And Brock Gutter Drunk is there, sitting on a fat little pony.
Oh, nice. Crap.
And we will stop, and we will stop there.
Oh.
No!
What?
No.
Oh.
Do we at least get paid?
Hey, we'll have to tune in next time to find out.
We didn't even get to show him the sword.
Oh, that's so awesome, though.
That is fun.
That was a blast.
That's good. Yeah, so if anybody is interested in checking out Tiny Dungeon, like I said, check out the Kickstarter. We just they just passed 55 grand, which is great. Alan, did you have any idea that you would have this much success on this campaign or what?
No, I have become a victim of my own success.
That's awesome. No, I think that's when something catches fire on Kickstarter and it kind of takes the creators by surprise, it's always it's a fun thing to see.
Yeah, it's been great. And I don't mean, I realize, that sort of sounds ungrateful, which is not what I intend to sound.
No, I don't think it,
But there's a point where you're like, oh man, this is so successful, I have way too much work that I was not planning for. So there's that moment of as a creator and a business person, a little bit of panic.
Right, don't like, screw this up, don't screw this up.
How am I going to get this all done in time? How am I going to make sure everybody's happy?
Well, right. Are you hiring?
you should get my email and shoot me an email.
Okay.
We can talk.
All right.
But and the really cool thing we're doing is, and this is one of the stretch goals early on, was a community content program where we'll release a monthly 1500 six Pretender Words, roughly 6 pages PDF that anybody can apply to write for.
Cool.
So it's like an open submission, and we'll just take the ones we want and we'll release them throughout the year. And at the end of the year, we'll compile all 12 into an omnibus, and then we'll do the same for the next year. And these are actual paying gigs. We paid the usual rate of 10 cents a word when we, that's our normal writer rate. So it's the full on paying gig. It's a kind of our own little community content program.
Awesome.
Cool.
Now, are you looking for any artists for these gigs as well? I mean, I'm just I kind of know a few artists, so I just, you know, I'm not trying to, you know, seal anybody out.
No, I am always, we are always looking for artists, more artists. Uh-huh. Amanda, you can shoot me an email.
Okay, well,
I did. Oh, Amanda, are you an artist? Wow, I didn't even I wasn't even.
Is this a thing I do? I don't know. Is it?
Yeah, no, there's always room for everything. So
that's awesome. And no, I'm really excited for you, Alan. I messaged you today, and you know, I was kind of busy at work, but I saw you passed 50 grand, and I was like, yes, like that's so awesome. And you, at one point we were talking on Twitter or something, and KickTrack had you pacing it like it was like 80 grand or something. You're like, yeah, you know, I'll be lucky if I hit 50 or something. You made some sort of comment that'd be like, you know, I'll be lucky if I hit 50, and now you're well above that, and it's just I'm very, very happy for you. I guess yeah. That's what I'm.
Well, I appreciate it. Thank you.
Yeah.
Very kind.
No. So yeah. So I guess. That's probably going to do it for this session. I will tell everybody that one of the stretch goals was a monthly, campaign or mm-hmm. For this channel. So if you are a fan of Tiny Dungeon, feel free to hit the subscribe button, hit the like button, or hit the little icon down below. The folks that are with me tonight are scheduled to be on this monthly campaign. So, and then we've got a few others as well. So we're going to see our ugly mugs, hopefully, well, three of our ugly mugs and Amanda's face.
Wait, who's the one we're not counting now?
Okay. Oh, wait a minute. There's four of us. I'm sorry.
So,
four of our ugly mugs and Amanda's.
Four of us and here are ugly.
You know what? Sorry. It's been a long day, man. And evidently, I still need to grow my beard out for this campaign, because I don't want to be the only guy without a beard on this. So, yeah.
I'm actually planning to shave, and this, it's just been a while.
Nice.
It's been a long week or two.
So, you know, please feel free to, you know, join us again in 2018. We're really, really excited about it. I know we're going to start in January, and we're going to go once a month right on through till December. We've got a lot of really fun things that we've got planned. We've already kind of started. The player characters that we've used are kind of ones that we've kind of created right, you know, yesterday and today, and we're not actually going to use these characters for our campaign. We've been talking about all sorts of different aspects of our characters. So we're putting a lot of time and effort into this, and we're really hoping that it's going to be something that you all are going to enjoy, really getting to hopefully get behind. And Alan, you said afterwards it's going to be released as a PDF or something later on?
Yeah, the adventure I run for our live stream will be released as a campaign.
Nice.
So,
very cool. Very
yeah,
cool.
Should be good.
Yeah, it should be a lot of fun. Are there any questions? I didn't really get a chance to really watch the chat. Were there any?
I handled all of it. Don't sweat it.
Did you really? Thank you very much. I appreciate that.
I can. I also posted a Kickstarter update in the middle of running that. So.
Oh. Wow. Wow, that's
so rules like on the GM side too. Apparently.
Yeah.
Yes, it was not terribly hard to run.
Now, Alan, let's talk about a little bit about the add-ons. There's a few other products that you've added to the campaign. Let's talk about that for folks that, because we didn't really get to showcase those in this session.
Right. So we've added a bestiary deck, which is a deck of cards with the monster art on one side and the monster stats on the other. So you can hold it up, show your players, this is what it looks like. And then you have the stats right there, so it's ready. We added a treasure item deck, which is a deck of 50 cards that'll have, you can shuffle it up. And if you need to say, oh, you find three magic items, you flip out three cards. Now you know what they are, and they're little reference cards.
Nice. Cool.
The whole goal is to make the book as not needed as possible in a large sense at the table. Like, we're really taking the minimalist thing to, like, as long as you have some D6s and 3x5 note cards, you can play Tiny Dungeon.
Nice.
Like, it's not hard. And then we unlocked a full campaign setting called The Destiny of Tides, written by Robert Denton, out of writing for Alderac Entertainment on L5R and stuff back in the day.
Nice.
Wow, he's fantastic. Cool. He's written all the Tiny D6 stuff we've done. He's doing a full underwater campaign setting, so it's about underwater beings that adventure onto the surface to go dungeon delving in the ruins of the former surface world.
Kind of like Gungans.
Kind of like not that at all.
No.
So he's doing, that'll be like a full 60-page campaign setting.
Very cool.
What else are we doing? We're doing the Tiny Dungeon app. It'll generate random dungeon rooms for you. It'll be free to all backers. All of this is free in PDF to all backers who pledge $13 or more.
Like, yeah, that's an incredible value.
Awesome. You get all this. Yeah. Then there's Tiny Frontiers Revised. One of our stretch goals was a revision of our first game, which was a great game, but now that we've done this for a bit, we can go, oh, we can do a lot better now. And we kind of have been itching for a chance to sit down and take a crack at it to, you know, kind of up the presentation of product.
Do you want to tell folks what Tiny Frontiers is?
Yeah, Tiny Frontiers is the first Tiny D6 game we made. It was a space opera. It's Star Trek or Firefly or Star Wars.
Nice.
Yes, and they get a copy of that that updated rules.
Okay, every backer gets the PDF of that.
So you're actually getting two RPGs in one.
Yes, and then we also have Tiny Dungeon 2E, the Hatchling Edition, which is it's Tiny Dungeon 2, but the game's being rewritten for casual and younger gamers. You should be able to hand this to a kid or somebody who's never played an RPG before, and they should be able to run a game immediately.
Nice.
Off of this framework, and we're taking an extra step, and we're showcasing a bunch of awesome female creators that we work with. And the entire production from ground up is all female. All the artists, all the layout, all the design. I'm overseeing the product to make sure it, you know, meets the Gallant Knight game standards from a upper level management perspective of, hey, you know, here's the minimum standard of quality we have to achieve, right? But I am only tangentially involved, other than kind of just rubber stamping things they want to do. It's been handed to Alana Jolie Abbott. She worked on the Serenity RPG. She worked on Kingdoms of Kalimar, stuff like that. She's been around the RPG for a long time, and she's tackling it, and she's really excited because she has a daughter who's just starting to get into RPGs. So
nice.
This is going to be a really, and that's a free PDF to all backers, or you can get a physical copy.
Very cool. Yeah, whose idea was that? Because that's a that's a really great, that's a great asset, and it's something that I don't think a lot of RPG companies have kind of grasped that there was there's an audience for that, and there is, and I got to see it at a convention this year. We had someone come in and actually do a role playing group just for kids, and it was a huge hit. We had I think there was like six kids at the table, and they all got into it, and so there is a market for that, and I hope more and more companies kind of and publishers kind of realize that there is that.
Yeah, it was my idea. I got it. Flying Frog Games did an edition of their last year of their RPG called Sword and Wizardry, and it was just, they were like, we're doing a new printing. We kind of wanted to do a different look, so we decided to have an all-female team tackle it. They didn't change the rules or anything. It was just the all-female team. Mm-hmm. But, you know, I don't have kids, and so I don't really know how to write an RPG for kids necessarily. Like, I understand the ideas that I would have to impart, but it's not something I have a ton of experience with. And my friend at my playgroup, we don't run a lot of RPGs that have, you know, anybody under the age of 18, really, at our table. So it's just not an audience I'm super familiar with on a personal level. So Alana was a great fit for the project. She was, you know, pretty much the best person I could imagine taking it over.
Yeah, that's great. No, it's like I said, it's a great move, and I think it's going to do a lot of good for Gallant Knight Games.
Awesome. Well, thank you.
No problem. All right, so I guess that's going to probably wrap it up for tonight. I want to thank everybody for coming on. I want to thank Alan, of course, for coming on and GMing and giving us a taste of Tiny Dungeon 2E. Hopefully we did a good enough job. I know we got kind of silly there for a while, and you know, but that's kind of the nature of things. And I hope you guys enjoyed it. If you did enjoy this, please give it a like down below. If you... you know, haven't subscribed to the channel, please consider subscribing. We have a lot of fun here at Victory Condition Gaming, and we do all sorts of different stuff. And we just love the gaming community, and we love getting together and just having fun more than anything else. I want to thank Amanda Call for coming on. Thank you, Amanda.
Thank you for having me.
Please check out her work. Where can folks find you, Amanda?
They can find my webcomic at ageofknight.com, and that's knight just with an N, not with a K.
Nice. Okay. Josh, thank you for coming on. Josh, where can folks find you?
You can find me on YouTube at Halloweenville and Facebook as well.
Nice. Jordan, thanks. I know it was kind of difficult for you tonight.
It's okay.
But you did a great job.
Glad he wasn't too much. I hope he wasn't too much of a disturbance.
Hey, you know what? We all have been there. We that's what families are about. You know, I appreciate you taking time out of your day and doing double duty and being the dad and being the gamer at the same time. And yeah. Where can folks find you if they want to check out your stuff?
Gamers Against Alzheimer's is on Facebook, and I'm also on Twitter at Gamers versus Alls.
There you go. And Alan, where can folks find you? Where can folks check out Gallant Knight Games?
Sure, you can go to gallantknightgames.com. You can go to Gallant K Games on Twitter. I mostly tweet under my at Alan Barr handle. I'm not very good at doing the Twitter for the company. And then you can also find Tiny Dungeon 2E on Kickstarter right now for the next 36 hours.
Nice. Are you gonna have late pledges as well?
Yep, we'll be doing backer kit.
Nice. So I can't
promise it'll be late pledges at the same rate, but it'll be at least a pre-order at a comparable level.
Excellent. All right, I guess that's going to do it for me as well. My name is Doug. You can check us out on Facebook at Victory Condition Gaming, and I'm also on Twitch and Twitter and. You know, just feel free if you're on the channel page. There's little icons up above. Feel free to check those out. We're also on Instagram. I post a whole bunch of stuff. It's a lot of it's not gaming related. Sometimes it's just personal related. So you know, if you like checking out some stupid things that I do online, feel free to check out my Instagram and my Facebook page and we'll. You know, I just have fun being a dad, being a parent, these three other players with me. And then, of course, I have a couple cats that drive me crazy, which, you know. Amanda, I just want to point out that every time it goes to you, it's you and then your cat, like, next to you. And the cat's, like, looking up at you like.
What are you doing? He's like, my familiar.
It's adorable. So, all right. Folks, thanks so much for watching. We'll see you on the next video. Until next time.
Good night, everybody.